Well, good morning. It's good to see you here and excited that God has brought you together. So please take note in the bulletin, the prayer request form that is there. If you need us to pray with you about anything, please put that in the offering plate when it passes and they'll give it to me and we'll make sure that everybody's praying with you. And so please know that. Also notice there's some other announcements in the bulletin. One has to do with a movie that's coming out that's going to be one of those one-night events. And so if you would like to be a part of that, the information is there in the bulletin for you as far as what that film is. And also wanted to take note of the fact that we're only 4 weeks away from Resurrection Sunday. Isn't that glorious? That means good weather's coming. Spring is coming this week, and Easter's on the way. So praise God. We want to celebrate Him, and we want to prepare ourselves for that. We want to begin this morning. Last week we shared with you a little bit about missions and about the offering that is received during this time of year. I know of no better way to prepare for Resurrection Sunday than to talk about how we can reach people and how we are reaching people in the United States of America, where it is desperately needed. And so our North American Mission Board helps to start brand new churches in new areas. So we just want you to see a little clip of one of the missionaries that you are supporting through this offering and what he is doing.
Thank you.
Boys and one wonderful sweet girl. It's good to see you today. And I brought something that I want to talk to you about. Anybody know what this is? Anybody? How many of you know what this is? Raise your hand. It's a what?
It's a spaceship.
What'd you call it?
Spaceship.
A spaceship.
Spaceship.
A spaceship or a rocket ship. It's got a clock on it, but we're not going to talk about the clock today. Because that's the best rocket ship that I can have. Now, let me ask you another question. How many of you would like to take a ride on a rocket ship? How many of you like to take a ride on a rocket ship and go way out in space? Go out there among those stars that we see in the sky? How many you'd like to do that? You'd like to do that. I think that would be pretty cool. So when you get back, tell me all about it, okay? When you get back, I think they have an age limit, so when you get back, tell me all about what that was like. Do you know what the most difficult part of the trip would be if you took a ride on a rocket ship?
Floating.
What would be the most difficult part? What would be the most difficult part? What did you say? What would be the hard part to make that trip?
Steering the rocket ship.
What's that?
Steering the rocket ship.
Steering the rocket ship. Ah, steering it. That might be hard. I would have a hard time with that. Because there might be things out there to bump into.
Not getting spacesick.
Yeah? Yeah? What else? What would be the hard part of making that trip? You know what would be the hardest part? Actually getting that rocket ship up off the ground. Do you know that's the hardest part? That's the reason when you see a launch of a ship that going out into space, it has all of that fire that's coming out of the bottom of it for it to be able to go way, way up in the sky. You know that's the hardest part. Did you know that? That's the hardest part. Once you get out there in space, it's a little bit easier part, but the hardest part is to be able to get away from Earth, to get out into space. That's the hardest part. Now, I know that. Don't ask me how I know that, but I know that. Now, here's the thing. Do you know that a lot of us look and we see what Jesus wants us to do and what Jesus wants us to be? And we think, I want to go there. I want to be that. I want to do what Jesus wants me to do. Okay? You know the hardest part of being what Jesus wants you to be?
Being Jesus.
It's getting started. Because as you try to be everything Jesus wants you to be, there's so many things trying to hold you down. So many things trying to keep you from being able to be there where Jesus wants you to be. It's kind of like going up in a rocket ship. The hardest part's just leaving the earth. And the hardest part of being what Jesus wants you to be is getting started and being able to be on that journey to where that all those things that would want to hold you down, those things fall away. And so things can try to hold you down. Things that might take your attention, might get you to do something that's not what Jesus wants you to do. But breaking loose of everything and being free so you can be with Jesus, that's the special part. Okay? So see if you can explain that to your mom and dad when you get home, okay? Tell them all about it and about the rocket ship and about how that's like us living for Jesus. So let's bow together for prayer. Everybody bow your head. Close your eyes. It's very important when we talk to Jesus. So let's bow our heads, close our eyes, and let's pray. Father, thank you that you put within the hearts of those who love you a desire to be what you want us to be. And Lord, we know that there are many things that would keep us from doing that. And so, Lord, I pray you'll give us victory. Let us, Lord, set those things aside and be free to be all that you'd have us be. Bless these children now. I pray that they would learn more and more about you, that the foundation might be built in their life of faith in you, that it might never be shaken. Bless the teachers now as they go. And Lord, we give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Now wait a minute. You have to wait till I say go. All right, now here's the thing. Some of you are older children. The older you are, the more you need to help the teacher. Okay? So the older you are, the more you need to help the teacher and help the younger ones know exactly what they're supposed to do. So go to your class now, have fun, and we'll see you later. You know, in working with people, you get to know them. I had the privilege of working with Brother Chip pretty closely over these last couple of years, and I've always found him to be a man of good judgment. And then this morning, with Lisa being out sick, he looked at me and asked, "Would you like to take her place?" He said it with a straight face, so I assumed he was serious, and I told him I'd be too big a distraction up here, that all of you just be amazed at my sense of rhythm and all of these things. So I declined, but anyway, so maybe he was right. Maybe that was good judgment. Get me involved. And so I appreciate that. Appreciate his confidence in me, if that's what it was. I was thinking about, this is one of those weeks to where, you ever had a week to where your computer just fought against you? Well, sometimes mine does that. I use the computer quite a bit. In fact, I've been using the computer longer than some of you can remember. In fact, I thought, how many years ago has it been since I first took a computer course? Now, that's been at least 30 years. Then added it up and realized it had been 46 years since I first took a computer course and took it in college. And I thought I would enjoy it because I heard that when you were working with computers, you gave it commands. And I like that. I like that. Now, back then, you gave it commands by punching cards. You know, using a machine to punch cards, you punched in your formula for it to follow so that it could do it. And then they fed your cards into this great big computer that was half the size of this room. And many times, the commands that I thought that I had given to the computer, I realized that somehow it didn't understand my commands. Now, I'm sure God has felt that way about me many times, that he's been very clear. Now, I know the difference was he was very clear in what he did. And yet, I've had trouble understanding just exactly what he wanted. As I said, my relationship with the computer continues to be a difficult one. Every now and then, it just freezes up on me. It just stops. All I can do at that point is turn it off and reboot it. Let everything come back up. And that's always frustrating because then I have to go in and bring back up my Bible software program, and I have to reload the things that have disappeared since when I had to reboot it, and pulling that all up, and what a difficult time that is. But that's part of it. Now, I've been taking a course and began it much earlier than I began fighting with computers, this course being a course in life. I've tried to apply some very basic principles of living so that life would have the outcome that I desire. But what I've gotten back has often been something far different than what I intended. I thought that I was heading in a right direction, and what I received was not what I anticipated. Well, I believe that I've identified my error, because some of my basic principles have been flawed. Some of the principles I was trying to apply were principles that I had learned elsewhere than in Scripture, elsewhere from the example of Christ, and I found that those did not work. So what do? When you find that life is not what you intended it to be, when you find that somehow you've missed the mark, when it seems that this God who promised you he would never leave you and never forsake you, when it seems that he's left you all alone. Now, I am convinced that if we are separated from God, if we are distanced from him, it's not he who moved and distanced himself from us, but it is our situation, our problem. In those times when it seems that everything gets stale and we're just going through the motions, when that has happened in my life, I'm trying to learn that what I need is a spiritual reboot. I need to go back and start from the basics. I need to go back and start from the very beginning. So when you come to that place where you learn that some of the basic principles by which you are living your life, and especially your spiritual life, when you find that all of that has grown stale and it's purposeless, at least on the surface, you think, why am I doing all of this? What you need is you need personal revival. What you need is you need to realize how you got where you are and go back and start again. Now, in this message, I want to share with you some truths that will, I believe, when applied, help your life begin to make sense. You see, sometimes your life doesn't make sense because you're approaching life in a nonsensical fashion. What I want to help you to do is to move from the place where you analyze the happenings of your life and try to make sense out of them to the place where you build your life in a way that makes sense for a person who believes in the life-changing message of salvation in Christ Jesus. It all comes back to him. I believe if you apply what the Apostle Paul has written to us in this passage of Scripture, that you will experience personal revival. Where there's dryness, that's going to all become ripeness. There's going to be fruit that is going to be born as you apply this. Now, I know this works. I know that what is written here works because I see it, because it has already been field tested by the Apostle Paul and many believers just like you. I can recommend them, these principles to you, what is said here on the basis of what was produced in Paul's life and in the lives of many others. So if you have a personal relationship with God, how did that come about? It came about because you placed your faith in what you could accomplish. Is that right? No. You placed your faith originally in what level of spirituality you could achieve. Is that how it began? No. You know how it began? With simple faith in Christ. Now, why do we ever move away from that? Why do we ever move away from that? It's all about Jesus. It's all about Christ. When you accepted Jesus, you had to stop believing in yourself. You had to admit that you needed a Savior and turn to Christ, and you accepted the promise of salvation. So go back to the beginning. It all began with Christ. And if you're to experience a return to the joy you once had, you've got to choose to center your very being in Christ. The center of your life has to be Jesus. You've got to center your very being in Christ. Listen to what it says in Philippians chapter 1 and verse 21. What did Paul write? He said, "For to me, to live is Christ." For to me, to live is Christ. Now I want you to know also, in the Greek sentence, in the original writing of this, there's written in Greek, there is no verb in this phrase. There is no is in this phrase in Greek. It simply says, "For to me to live, Christ." For to me to live, Christ. Paul was testifying of a way of life, an attitude that he had about the approach to life. In other words, for me to live, it has been Christ, it is today Christ, and it will be Christ. Can we not see in the Apostle Paul's life that that's exactly what it was ever since he found Christ, ever since Christ found him, ever since that time, that it was about Christ, it was at this moment that he was writing about Christ, and it would continue to be about Christ. And that's simple. Right? It wasn't 50% Christ and 25% eternally meaningless hobbies and 25% friends. No, he said, "For to me to live, Christ." Now, what does that mean? What do we know about Christ in his primary purpose in life? Well, he said in Luke chapter 19, verse 10, "For the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which was lost." Aren't you glad that that's the reason he came? Because that is where all of us were before he came to us. And then what do we know about Paul's primary purpose in life? Well, listen to what he says in 1 Corinthians 9, 22, where he says, "I have become all things to all men so that I may by all means," do what? "Save some." So in other words, Christ's primary purpose was Paul's primary purpose. Now, what do we know about how Christ lived his life? He said in Matthew chapter 20, verse 28, "Even as the Son of Man came not to be ministered unto, but to minister." Well, what do we know about Paul and how he lived his life? Paul asked in 1 Corinthians 3, 5, "Who then is Paul and who is Apollos but," what? "Ministers." The word used for minister there, both by Jesus and by Paul, is the Greek word diakonos, which literally means through the dust. It is coming to that very lowest place and serving others. In Romans 15, 16, we read where Paul refers to himself in this way. He says, "I am the minister of Jesus Christ to the Gentiles, ministering the gospel of God." Now here where he talks about ministry, this is a different word. This word minister means specifically one who works for the sake of others. He says, "This is what I'm doing. I'm ministering the gospel of Christ, not for my sake. It's not so that I can talk about how faithful I am and what I'm doing." He says, "I am ministering for the sake of others." In other words, his life was not about him, but about others. And certainly that's what we see about Christ Jesus when he came. It was not about him, but it was about us. Now, why did Paul see himself in this manner? Well, that's exactly what Jesus told him in the very beginning. Maybe you were told something else when you put your faith in Christ, but listen to what he was told. In Acts chapter 26 and verse 16, Paul quotes Jesus as having said to him, "I have appeared unto thee for this purpose, to make thee a minister and a witness." A minister, there's that word again, at least in English. In Greek, it's a little bit stronger because this no longer is the word diakonos, through the dust, but this is an even stronger word. It's a word which meant an under rower. It was those men who were down in the very belly of the ship who were rowing. And if you know anything about those old ships and that task, there was no more difficult task in all of the world than that. No hotter, dirtier place than that. Well, that's exactly what Jesus told him was to be his situation. Now, maybe you were told something different. Maybe you were told that somehow that your salvation was all about you and not about others. Maybe you were told about all the things that how this would make your life better. But I want to tell you, when you trust Jesus Christ as Lord, you become his servant and a minister to others. But did Jesus say this about us? Was it just about Paul? Well, listen to Mark 10, verses 43 to 44. He said, "Whoever wishes to become great among you shall be your what? Servant. And whoever wishes to be first among you shall be slave of all." There is that same word, diakonos. There is that same word, through the dust. There is that same word, servant. Now, today in our society, in our world, it seems that this is a very unpopular thing to speak about and talk about. But remember that what we're saying is that if we're going to get life straightened out, if there's going to be revival in our hearts, if we're going to draw close to Christ, then we need to have that attitude that Paul had where he said, "For to me to live is Christ." It's Christ. Most of our problems with life and life not making sense to us is because we have tried to live our lives anchored in self and not in Christ. We rebel against the idea that we need to put aside ourselves and minister the way Jesus would minister. Now, if there's not that sense of rebellion in your heart right now, praise God for that. But most of the time, when it comes to service, when it comes to ministry, we think, "I didn't sign up for this." Really? Really? I accepted Jesus as my what? As my Lord, as my Master. That's what I signed up for. So whatever He would have me to do, that's what life is about. When you live your life that way, you can face the end of your life the way Paul faced his. Now, many Christians today have a problem with thinking about life ending, and they dread it just like the world dreads it. But that wasn't the attitude of the Apostle Paul. You know what the Apostle Paul said? He said, "For to me to live is Christ, and to die is what? It's gain." That is a positive thing. This is one of those principles that we claim to believe, at least about others. They've gone to a better place. Their sufferings are now over. They are in the presence of the Lord Jesus, and we say, good for them. We're trying to make ourselves feel better. But when it comes to us, we think what a dreadful time that will be when in weakness this body is laid down and life is over. Paul said, "For to me to live is Christ, and to die is gain." The psalmist was able to say, "Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me." Now, those who have walked through the valley of the shadow of death and have been sustained by the Lord can anticipate death itself with hope and with assurance. Do you remember how that same 23rd Psalm ends? "Surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." You see, when you've walked with Christ during your life, when you've walked with Him through the valley of the shadow of death, you know that you have a certainty that when life is over, you can dwell in the house of the Lord forever. I like that picture a lot better. People say, well, when I get to heaven, I'm going to have a mansion. You're going to have a mansion. I hope we're neighbors when we get there. I want to tell you, I don't want to be your neighbor. I want to live in Jesus' house. I want to be right there with Him. I don't want to be neighbors to... If you're in there with me, then you can be my neighbor. But not separated. That's not what He was talking about. That's never what He said. He was talking about He's gone to prepare a place for us. It is in His Father's house. It is Jesus' house. And we can look forward to that time and look forward to that day. So what does it say about our present life and our present faith if we are troubled about our eventual death? If I'm troubled about that, it means that I have a problem with my life. And I need to be revived. I need to be brought back to the right place. You've heard the expression, you can't take it with you, right? Who would want to? Which one of you would want to? Who would think that by anything that you have here in this earth that you can make heaven a better place by taking it with you? You think you can? What do you have that you think is greater than those streets of gold and being able to be in the very presence of the Lord Jesus Christ? Is there anything that you can take with you that would improve your experience in heaven? I don't think so. All of it's going to be left behind, and praise God it is. Now, if you think there could be anything better, what you need is a good reboot. Maybe you need a good boot, swift kick. I don't know. But at least to reboot, at least to come back to that place where you say, I'm going back to the beginning. I'm going back to where it's all about Jesus. So that I can understand life and so I can be positive about even death. He said to die is gain. Gain not lost. To have the privilege of seeing our Lord Jesus, worshiping Him face to face, experiencing perfect peace, experiencing unspeakable joy. You've also heard it said of some people that they are so heavenly minded that they're no earthly good. Well, let me tell you, that's not what the Apostle Paul lived. It could never be said of him. Follow Paul's example. He said in verse 22 of this first chapter of Philippians, but if I am to live on in the flesh, this will mean fruitful labor for me. Now, some people feel that they can't win for losing. Well, Paul was convinced that he could not lose for winning. That it was all going to be victory. Either he would be worshiping Christ in heaven or he'd be working for Christ on earth. Additional days on earth would simply amount to additional fruit to lay at the feet of Jesus when he finally got to heaven. You see, that was true because his life was not about him but about Jesus. His future was not about him, but his future was about Jesus. He didn't complain to God about what God wanted him to do. He counted serving God as a privilege. So format your life's computer with that and see what a difference that it makes. Do otherwise and you'll enter into heaven empty-handed. And I don't think you want to do that. You want to be able to stand there knowing that you've served the Lord Jesus Christ, that what you've done has been for His benefit. Okay? So reboot and go back to that place. Second thing I want to say to you is to consider your blessed dilemma. Your blessed dilemma. Dilemma is normally a negative word, but consider your blessed dilemma. It's a blessed dilemma when you have a difficult choice to make between two very appealing offers. Paul says in verse 22, and I do not know which to choose, but I am hard-pressed from both directions. Paul says he is hard-pressed. The term itself speaks of being on a very narrow road with two stone walls, with a stone wall on either side of you, and you're pressed in so tight you can't turn this way, you can't turn that way, you have to keep going forward. That is the word for hard-pressed. You may have heard people speak of being between a rock and a hard place, right? Well, that's not what Paul's talking about. That's pretty much the opposite, because being between a rock and a hard place means that you have two alternatives of which neither are desirable. That's the way we use that. But Paul found himself hemmed in. But what was it that was causing him to be hemmed in like this? His desire to be with Jesus in heaven was on one side. Oh, what a glorious thing that was. What a glorious anticipation he had of that, to be with his Lord. And on the other side was his desire to minister to the saints on earth. Well, he was excited about both. On the one hand, he speaks in verse 23, saying, having the desire to depart and be with Christ, for that is very much better. There's nothing better than that. I love you, but I love Jesus a whole lot more. I'd lots rather be with Jesus. And if you know my Jesus, you feel the same way. You feel the same way. Having the desire to depart. The word desire means a burning desire. It means a red-hot craving. Most of us are so comfortable in the flesh that we are satisfied to know that we're going to see Jesus someday, and it's okay with us if that day isn't too soon. Okay? That's the way most people are about life. We know we're going to see Him, but it doesn't have to. I'm not worried about it being really soon. The word used in verse 23 that is translated desire speaks of excitement. Paul was excited about the two possibilities that lay before him. He says, having the desire to depart. That word depart means to unloose. It means to break camp. It means to weigh anchor and put out to sea. Paul knew that earth was just a temporary excursion out into the wilderness. In other words, he was just camping out down here. Now, when you go camping, you may enjoy camping, but you know you're going home. You know you're going home. And every time I went camping, I enjoyed it, but I loved it when I walked through the door and I was home. All right? Well, that's what the Apostle Paul is talking about. You might say that he was just like a ship in the port that was there just for a brief time. He was ready to weigh anchor and set out for his true home. Again, our problem is not that we are so heavenly minded that we're no earthly good. Most professing Christians today are so earthly minded that they are no heavenly good. Do we need revival? Do we need a fresh awakening? Do we need for God to move in a fresh way, in a new way in our lives? Indeed we do. Do you understand how much better it will be to be with Christ? Would you be, if today were the day that you left earth, would you be glad to go to be with Him? If it was His will, if it was that day, you served Him faithfully throughout your life, you're in that state of obedience before Him, and He said, child, it's time to come home. I'm ready. Paul's life ended in what some would feel was a disaster. Paul lived his life knowing that however his life ended, he wanted to glorify God in his death, even as he glorified God in his life. See, he had a desire to go and be with God, but he had a second desire that held him steadily in the path that God had set before him. Look at verse 24. He says, yet to remain on in the flesh is more necessary for your sake. Now, when you're in love with Jesus, you cannot help seeing others as He sees them. He saw a need in the lives of others, and he realized that God was using him to meet that need. Paul understood that his life on earth was not simply about Paul. It was not even just about him and his personal relationship with Christ. It was about him as a minister of the truth with a ministry of encouraging and equipping the saints so that they could serve the Lord. Paul was motivated to keep on keeping on for the sake of his brothers and sisters in Christ and those that had not yet come to faith in Christ, who would come to faith in Christ through the testimony of those in whom he was pouring his life and those he would personally lead to faith in Christ. You see, he was desperate to attend to their needs. In verse 25, it says, convinced of this, I know that I will remain and continue with you all for your progress. The word translated progress is that word translated in the King James Version as furtherance. It means to administer a blow and go forward. That is what happens when that rocket ship leaves the launch pad. It administers a blow so that it is driven in the opposite direction. I used to know how thick, how deep that foundation was of that pad, that launching pad down at Cape Canaveral. That shows how old I am. Cape Kennedy, I think it's called now. I used to know how deep that thing was. Anybody know? I've asked a couple of wise men already this morning, and they gave me wrong answers. How deep that was. That's your assignment this week. See how deep it was. How deep it is. Because they knew that in order to propel those ships upward, they had to first go down into the earth. One of those wise men told me, well, you know, an architect knows that the skyscraper can only be so tall. How tall the skyscraper is depends on how deep the foundation goes down into the ground. Well, Paul talked about the fact, he says, I'll continue with you for your progress, for your furtherance, so that you can strike a blow, so that there can be something explosive about your relationship with Christ, so that you can make a difference in this world. So when you watch that launch of a spaceship, and that fire burns for a few seconds, and then it goes up, you wait, and all of a sudden it begins to go up. Know what is happening there. The blow is being struck, and then the ship is able to go forward. The thrust of that rocket pushing downward pushes the shuttle upward. And once the space shuttle has used up all the energy of the rocket booster, the booster falls away. The weight of the booster would be too much weight to carry it out into space, and so it simply drops away. It has served its purpose. Paul knew that when he had served his purpose, he'd be released. When you live that way, that's living in perpetual revival. When you know that you have a desire to be with Christ, but the reason He's left you here is so that you might have an impact on others. We look at Paul and we realize how important he was to the cause of Christ. Paul looked forward and saw how important, now listen to me, we look how important he was to the cause of Christ. Paul looked forward and saw how important the saints of God in Philippi and in the other places, the other churches were to the cause of Christ. If any of us just look at ourselves and think, what's God going to do without me here on earth? We messed it up big time, right? No, my joy is that maybe through teaching and encouraging, maybe I can equip the saints of God so that they can go forward and they can reach other people so that they might be able to carry on the ministry. You are they. And I praise God for what He's doing in your lives. I praise God for the progress that is being made in your lives. He was willing to remain and continue with them for their progress. Now that's the type of advancement we should be willing and eager to face. That is frontier advancement. And there is new territory to be conquered for the glory of the Lord Jesus Christ. I know we live in a difficult day. I understand that. I understand that we're in the minority. I understand that the things that we teach are not popular today. I don't care if they're popular with man. As long as they're faithful to God. He's the one who will enable you to strike a blow. One of our most basic problems is that we do not properly consider the life that we have that would please God. Satan wants us to believe that we're giving up life when what we're really doing is gaining life. Remember the words of Jesus when he said in Matthew 16:25, "For whoever wishes to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses it for my sake will find it." When your life, when you're not thinking about yourself, when you're thinking about Christ, when you're absorbed with what He wants and you desire to please your Master, you are living in that state of revival. May it spread, may it be contagious, may it be something that is true in every one of our lives. Listen to the Apostle Paul again in verse 25. He said, "Convinced of this." Do you hear that? Convinced of this. Is that not the problem today? That we are not convinced? Convinced of this, I know that I will remain and continue with you all for your progress and, how does that verse end? And your joy in the faith. The life I've been talking about is the life of great what? Great joy. You're looking for joy? You find it in Christ. That's the only place you're going to find true joy. The Christian life is a life of joy as we are able to make progress, as we become more and more like our precious Lord. Much of our joy comes from having been able to bless others and to be blessed by others. What a blessing, what a joy, what a tremendous benefit this is. Such a relationship is much to be desired. Look at verse 26. He says, "So that your proud confidence in me may abound in Christ Jesus through my coming to you again." Proud confidence is boasting. Now, boasting about yourself is an undesirable trait. Boasting which abounds in Christ Jesus about someone who has blessed your life is much desired because the Lord gets glory for it. So if you want to be an encouragement to somebody, if somebody has blessed you, you let them know that they have been a blessing to you in Christ. Give God, that gives God glory. You don't worry about that believer that you tell that to, because if their head begins to swell, God will deal with them about that. But encourage them and let them be a joy to you. Folks, sometimes your life doesn't make sense because you approach life in a nonsensical fashion. How did you find your joy in Christ in the beginning and somehow you let that get away from you? Remember, what I've been sharing with you has been field tested in the life of the Apostle Paul, even in the earthly life of the Lord Jesus Christ. So I can recommend this to you based on what they experienced. Few people will make such a radical change in their lives without experiencing genuine revival. Is it possible for us to let Christ be, our life be all about Christ and us not be in perpetual revival? I don't think so. The closer you are to Jesus, the more you think of Him and less of yourself, as we allow Him to increase, as John the Baptist said, "He must increase, I must decrease." Some of us need to reboot our spiritual lives, to go back and start from the beginning. Go back to the beginning. And there'll be a lot of things that are good that you can add back into your life. But you go back to the basic of Jesus Christ. Let me ask you, have you placed your faith and trust in Him? Has your life been radically changed by Him? Have you accepted Him as Lord and Master of your life? If not, you're missing the greatest joy and the greatest peace and the greatest sense of purpose that can possibly be. I'm going to ask our worship team to come, Chip and Jan to come this morning. And I'm going to ask you to respond to what God has said to you. It may be that there's something I've said that you need to talk to the Lord about. If there's something I can pray with you about, I'll be glad to do so. I'll be here at the front in case you want to do that. But I want this to be a time of surrender and a time of commitment. Would you let Him speak to your heart?